if you can keep as many of your different kinds of natives as possible and still be fire safe, then that would be terrific, because then you're supporting those populations of unique bees. And the other thing, many of them are ground nesters, so that means you should have some areas of bare ground for them, or to see holes in a certain area. Try to keep that weed free, or don't mulch it. Now, weed master gardeners always say mulch, mulch, mulch. But in this case, have some bare ground for the bees. And then the dead tree issue. You need a couple of dead trees, and what you can do is just clear around them so that they're fire safe too, more or less. But that dead wood helps those bees, which I think most of the bees, two-thirds of the bees, are ground dwellers, and a third are wood dwellers. So that's just something to keep in mind. So let's begin. I'm going to talk about the other pollinators in your yards. And the bees are the best pollinators, and in fact, they have done studies where they found out that native bees compete with honeybees, and that makes honeybees work harder. So it makes honeybees also be better pollinators. So there are other animals, and I'm going to be talking about them today, and I know you're familiar with many of them. But first, we're going to talk about the insects, because the insects tend to be the top pollinators as well. And what makes a good pollinator? Well, just like his pollinating pooch, they need to be very mobile. They should have hairs, or like butterflies, scales on their wings, or feathers that catch the pollen and then spread from flower to flower. They also typically have specialized mouth parts, and this dog has a nice tongue for that. So the groups we're going to be talking about, we've already heard about the bees, so we'll be focusing on wasps, flies, moths, butterflies, and beetles. And there are, just as Dan was demonstrating or illustrating, there are so many different kinds of animals in each one of these categories that we couldn't possibly cover all of them. So I'm just going to give a couple of examples in our limited amount of time we have here. So I know you all recognize this guy here. Yellow jackets, hornets, meat bees, and as Dan was telling you earlier, they basically provision their hives with meat or protein. So that's why they are so bothersome at picnics when they're going around, going after your chicken sandwich, but they also visit flowers. And this isn't something we think about too often, I don't think. And because the adults actually feed on nectar, rotting fruit, and even your sodas, they like sweetness because that's a carbohydrate that gives them energy. But they're no longer growing anymore, so they don't actually eat meat themselves. They feed that to their larvae, to their young. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about a couple of interesting wasps that you may have seen here in Mariposa. You all familiar with that guy there? The tarantula hawk. And that's one of our largest wasps. It's about an inch and a half. It looks a lot bigger than that to me when I get too close. But it's a solitary nester. So, and what she does is, you may have heard, she hunts the tarantula when the tarantulas come out in the fall. So this time of year, you will see them on flowers, especially the narrow-leaf milkweed. That seems to be one of their favorites. And, of course, milkweed's an important plant for what animal? The monarch butterfly. Yes, it's a food plant. We'll talk about that later. But there are many different kinds of spider wasps. So you may see ones that are really small, that remind you of a tarantula hawk, that have the orange-red wings. They may be a metallic blue color. And what they have in common with each other is that they typically have long, slender legs. And when they're walking around on the ground, either looking for a place to dig a burrow in the ground to put the spider, they twitch their wings. So this and this species here that lives in the foothills. So when they bloom, go out and take a look and see if you can see this interesting wasp. And again, the male's antennae are longer and they're knobbed, kind of like a butterfly would have. So that's interesting. So the male has long and then the females are shorter. And look at this little heart in there. Isn't that pretty? So that's the heart wasp, because it won't probably bother you at all. And there's a great book called The Pollen Wasp that gives you more information if you get interested in it. So we are going right next to the flies. And of course, we all just kind of like wasps. We have a negative opinion about flies because they are bothersome and they come into our houses and that sort of thing. But I hope today you'll have a little bit of a different opinion. And by the way, the wasps are considered beneficial because of all the caterpillars and spiders. Well, the spiders are the good guys too, actually. But other insects that they prey upon for their young. So they're considered beneficial. So this fly is on a carrot flower. And it turns out that in agriculture, the people who grow carrots and onions love to get flies in there because they're the best pollinators of those crops, and then they have seed for the next year because the flowers have been pollinated. So this is really important to know, I think. I had no idea that they actually, just kind of like the alfalfa bee and the other bee that Dan was talking about that are used commercially, so are the flies. The bees don't seem to like those flowers. And also, like many of the bees, there are mimickers of bees. So the flies mimic some bees. And what's the first difference between this bee fly and this bee? What do you see? If you were out in the field and you saw this, what would tell you that that's a fly, not a bee?
No fuzz.
The what?
No fuzz.
Well, that's true. It's not very hairy. That's, yes.
2 wings.
Well, it does have 2 wings, yes. Diptera means 2 wings. That's the order of flies. And, however, it's hard to see sometimes if they're buzzing around or flying around. And it's also hard to see 4 wings on the bee. But that is another difference. But the way I can tell right off the bat is when I look at the eyes. Look at that. I mean, that's a fly eye, right? And it covers most of the head, whereas the honeybee, and of course I'm not talking about all the native bees we just learned about, but the honeybee has, the eyes are kind of on the side and they're oval. And the antennae are shorter on the fly. Now, after I said that the hairy, they lack hairs, there is, of course, there are always exceptions to every rule in nature. And this bee fly really wants to look like a honeybee. You'll notice that, or a bumblebee, you'll notice its tongue is quite long. And it actually has a similar genus name. Bombilius major. So it does something interesting too. It actually parasitizes the nests of other bees, wasps, and beetles. And so it doesn't build a nest or anything like that. Another fly that you might see around here is the small-headed fly. And obviously you can see how disproportionate the head is from the rest of the body. And in fact, abdomen is also quite wide, and then the thorax, the middle part, is kind of humped over. So that'll tell you right there And then Dan was also talking about the serpent fly, and they come in all different colors too and looks, and they're beneficial. If you know it's a serpent fly, then you know you've got, and it's in your yard, you know you probably have serpent larvae, which actually eat and prey on aphids and thrips. And so if you have a rose plant and you're thinking, oh, look at all these aphids, I'm going to go get some spray, well, you might be killing some of these beneficials also. And we always, as master gardeners, say, do the most benign thing first, and that would be just get the holes and spray the plant, so get rid of the aphids that way. But anyway, so here's a fly that's beneficial to all of us. It not only pollinates our plants, but it also has larvae that eats up the bad things. And, okay, so tachyflies. They look just like a housefly, I mean, unless you really get down and start studying the differences. And the tachyflies lay their eggs on different caterpillars and spiders and things like that. This particular tachyfly is going to lay its eggs on this hornworm, tomato hornworm. And the tomato hornworm is feasting on somebody's tomato plant. And so what will happen is it will lay its eggs on there, and then the eggs will hatch and eat into the caterpillar. And then it's gruesome. And then the caterpillar will be eaten by, inside out, by these maggots or fly larvae, and then the fly larvae will hatch out as flies. And I actually, when I was in, well, 30 years ago, I had one of these tomato hornworms, and I knew that they turned into a sphinx moth. So I wanted to see what type of a sphinx moth looked like. So I brought it in, I set up an aquarium, I fed it my tomato plants, and one day it was on the ground. I had dirt because I heard that they go underground to pupate. So I had this dirt floor for it. It went underground. Well, before it went underground, it was arching up and writhing around, and it was acting really strangely. And anyway, it got down, finally started digging a hole about at the end of the day, and it was gone. So I thought, okay, it's going to hatch out. I don't know how long it takes. So I put a screen around the top of it. And I was going to release it once I was able to identify it. Because I'm not like one of those entomologists who likes to pin things and kill things. That's just not who I am. So several weeks later, I look in and I see four flies flying around. I thought, how did the flies get in there? And I was just, I couldn't understand how flies could get in there. Anyway, I had to do research, and that was before the internet. And I found out, and then I looked and I said, yeah, oh, those are tachyphid flies, and they were in my caterpillar. And so I never did get to see what the caterpillar turned into, what kind of a moth it looked like. But I did learn about nature. So there are quite a few Lepidoptera. In fact, they are the second largest order of insects as far as their numbers go. However, only 800 of those 12,000 are butterflies. But they both, there's some differences, and I apologize for my little map, it's a little blurry, but I think you can get the basics of it. And moths tend to be duller colored because they're at night and their wings are at their side. Anyway, you guys can read all that, I think. But, and I think you all know from going to school and everything, you all understand the metamorphosis of a butterfly. So it's an egg, and then it's a caterpillar or a tube or a larva, and then it pupates and has a pupa or a chrysalis, and then it hatches out as a moth or a butterfly. And one thing to keep in mind is that all of these animals need a food plant to feed on, and it's a particular food plant for that particular species, whether it's a moth or a butterfly. So that cock moth. I didn't even want to write on his photo what it was, because it's such a perfect photo. But Dan looked it up, and what is it again, Dan?
White-lined?
A white-lined sphinx moth. So this is not the tomato hardware moth. I still don't really know what that looks like. And look at that proboscis or that tongue. That can go into any kind of flower it wants. And you often, how many of you guys have seen these flying around in the late afternoon before? Yeah, they're almost the size of a hummingbird. And so a lot of times on the side of your eye, you think, oh, that's a hummingbird. And then you take a close look and you go, oh, gosh. And there it is, looking forward. Great shot. So another moth that you might see flying around in the daytime, even though most of them are at night, is this tanucha. And it'll be visiting flowers around, and that's actually a moth that's flying during the daytime. Remember, though, that at night, most of the bees, wasps, and butterflies are gone to bed. And so who's going to do the pollinating of the night flowers? Many of our moths. So moths do have a purpose, and I know a lot of us have a hate-love relationship, or maybe a hate-hate relationship with moths, because they get into our flower, they eat our clothes, but that's a very small percentage of the moths that are a problem. The tiger moth on the left is also a day-flying moth, so you might see one of these. I saw one that was a black and white one, and it was pollinating buckeye flowers in the daytime, and I was like, what is that? Because I had never seen anything like it. I know my butterflies pretty well, but not that. So it was a moth, a night-flying moth or a day-flying moth. And then this one here is the geometer moth, and that's one that flies at night. And I think they come in green colors and different colors, or shades of brown or gray. But they have these distinctive lines. And what's really interesting about them is they're called geometer because meter. We're talking about their larva, which is an inchworm. The little green inchworms, you know? And that's really an unusual caterpillar, because most caterpillars have their legs up on the front. But the inchworm actually has a pair in the back, so it can do that kind of a, you know, I'm not being entertained, but you've seen them. And so that comes from that moth there. And then this is the underwing moth. They have an incredible way of camouflaging themselves. They usually are up against a tree, and you can't see them unless they have their wings spread like this. And typically, though, they won't until you come up, and then they'll show you that flash, and you go, oh, and then they'll fly away. And that's supposed to be a way that they can protect themselves from birds by startling them or any other animal that might get a close look at them, see them as food. And that's the other thing I want to say, is that these moths, all these thousands of moths, feed many birds. And by the way, this underwing moth the larva will also eat oaks or oak leaves, but the birds are always in the oaks looking for caterpillars like this. So let's talk a little bit about the butterflies. And you know, the skipper butterfly is a little different. Some people used to think it was a moth because it's not brightly colored. And its wings are kind of strange. They're kind of like in this V shape, these two V shapes. They, of course, like most insects, have the two pair of wings. And these skippers, as they're called, there's so many different kinds of skippers, and they are really challenging to identify. So again, if you're good at photography, or if you have a net, you just want to look at it really closely and get a book out and try to identify it, that's another way of doing it. But I believe most of the skippers only, their caterpillars only eat grasses. And there's a couple that even eat Bermuda grass, ryegrass. There's all kinds of, and that list of references that you have there, that you got as a handout, it'll tell you for those things in the two butterfly books that I've mentioned in there. So if you can get those books, it'll tell you what butterflies show, so I'm kind of a fan. Not that they're fantastic, but I took this one off my deck. A bird had put one of the sunflower seeds that I feed them into a pot and out through the sunflower. Not a very big sunflower, but then I found the western tiger swallowtail nectaring on it, and I took a picture of that one. And then this one is on a coyote mint, which is a native plant here, and it's Monardella is the mint family. And you'll notice that butterflies, one thing about butterflies when they are nectaring for themselves as an adult, that they like to go where there's a lot of little flowers all in a cluster. And a sunflower has that in the middle. And so they are at one spot getting the nectar. And same thing with the coyote mint. It has all these little tiny flowers that are in one spot. So they don't have to waste a lot of energy flying around. Because, you know, the adult's main purpose is to find a mate and lay eggs on its host plant. But it's got to find a host plant for the young. And the western tiger swallowtail likes the willows and alders. Here's another butterfly that you may have seen. It looks very much like the western tiger swallowtail, but its background is not dark yellow. It's kind of pale, pale yellow. And it feeds off of the host plants are ceanothus and coffeeberry. So don't get rid of all your buckbrush and all those other plants. Leave a little bit for the caterpillars and our other pollinators. This is another common butterfly. Dan, I think, took this picture again, and it's on another kind of milkweed that we have here in the foothills. I think this milkweed might be in Yosemite Valley. Okay. So that's Clucius. Not if you guys want to know that, but speciosa. But you do, if you do have milkweed plants, you need to know which species they are. You don't want to buy the East Coast milkweed because that milkweed doesn't go with our butterflies. I'll talk about that in a minute. But anyway, the orange sulfur likes plants in the pea family. And so I'm wondering about that bee, the alfalfa bee. I'm wondering if it used to go to, or still does maybe, go to some of these other pea-like plants, lupins, clovers, vetches. Maybe a redwood, if that's a big pea plant. And this is another beautiful butterfly that we have around here, the common buckeye. Again, this is another picture, I believe, the Dan's duck. And it's on the milkweed, getting nectar. So, this host plant, there's a lot of different plants it has. So it has a lot of variety to choose from, including a yellow monkey flower that typically you'll find in seeps or springs. And owl's clover, which is blooming right now. And something else you have to think about is how are these butterflies overwintering? So some of them overwinter as an egg, some overwinter as a caterpillar, some, like some of the bees, were overwintering as an egg and then a larva. And then some overwinter as in a chrysalis. And then some overwinter as an adult. And this is one of them that does that. The morning cloak. So the morning cloak, and there's a couple of other butterflies I want to show you. These are a couple of other of the butterflies that hibernate during the winter and will come out on a warm day. The red admiral needs stinging metal. And I just took this picture this spring, and I didn't know I had any metal. I've never come across it, so it must be somewhere in the area. But if you have a patch of stinging metal, I've heard you can eat it if you boil it. But also leave a little patch if it's not going to be bothersome for these beautiful butterflies, for their larvae. And then the tortoiseshell also needs ceanothus, in particular the buckbrush and California lilac, which has just finished blooming it this year. The ceanothus was quite a show. It was really glad that we got rain this year. And then another thing you might see, this isn't a great picture, I apologize for that, but this is puddling behavior. So the butterflies, the adult butterflies, go to a mud pot or a wet area, and if you want to make something like this, because they have minerals in there and they also get water, you can put a shallow dish or the bottom of a flower pot. You can fill it with sand, and then you can fill that with water. And if you have a lot of butterflies in your yard, they will go there to get water. That way they won't drown. And again, the open, this aster plant provides all those little flowers, not just for butterflies, but for bees too, for easy picking. And the butterflies have taste buds on the front of their 4 feet, 6 feet. The feet in the front also can taste. And so then that stimulates the butterfly to put out its long tongue and go ahead and get some nectar. These are other plants that you can grow in your yard if you have the water source. Anything in the sunflower family, zinnias, cosmos, these will attract all kinds of butterflies and pollinators. It's just really fun. Also think about lilacs. Let's see, what's another one? Lilacs, oh, the butterfly bush. With those flowers, the buddleia flowers, they are all together. And so again, they don't have to fly around. They just land on one flower head and get nectar from all of those sources. So also, there are butterflies that migrate, not very many. The painted lady is the butterfly that next weekend, they're going to be celebrating and releasing lots of these painted ladies for the parade. And it was believed that the Spanish came across the big migrating group of these butterflies and were overwhelmed. That's how Mariposa's name came about. So that's the butterfly we believe is our namesake, so to speak. And as you may have noticed, it feeds on lots of different plants, thistle, yarrow, which is a native here, mule ears, which is a composite or a daisy plant, mallow, which is a weed, cheese weed is mallow. So it feeds on a lot of different plants, whereas the barn only milkweed. Great. There's a couple of butterflies that look similar to this one. There's the West Coast lady, and there's another one, I can't think of, American lady, I think it is. But so you need to learn the pattern of the white spots that are just in the black area, not on the orange.
What about the California sisters?
Yes, I'll bring that up. Yeah. Thank you. And then here's the monarch. This is kind of a ratty looking monarch. It was raised in captivity. I just wanted to show you the veins on this butterfly. See these little swellings here? That tells you that there are pheromones in the part of the vein, and that's a male monarch butterfly. So you can actually identify a male monarch from a female monarch. The female monarchs, they're pervasive. they tend to fly that long way all the way down to Mexico. And they have been really in trouble because of, oh, so many things. The pesticides that are being used on the crops, the spraying on the roads, and the milkweed grows in places that have been disturbed, like roadsides, and or near crops. And so some of that is, that pesticide comes over. There's now a lot of nurseries are using plants that have neonicotinoids in them, which is a poison that kills any insect. And I really don't think that's necessary, but it'll also kill the butterflies and all the beneficials in our native bees. It'll kill all our pollinators, and we need our pollinators because we need our food. But anyway, I digress. So our butterflies, this is kind of what happens, is that the monarchs will come to the coast and they rest. How many have you seen the monarchs hibernating in the, typically their eucalyptus groves along the coast? So what a special treat that is. And they stay there for about 7 months, and then they go back and travel east and north and looking for milkweed. They lay their eggs on the milk, and then about 5 days later, the eggs hatch. The larvae start to feed immediately on the milkweed, and within a quick amount of time, they pupate, and 10 days later, they hatch out as a new butterfly. That butterfly lives anywhere from 2 to 6 weeks. And then and it goes, does the same thing, travels north. Anyway, there's about 4 generations of that, and they only live 2 to 6 weeks. But the last, the fourth generation, is the one that lives the longest, and they then go to these places on the coast, and they hibernate. They're kind of in a torpor, so they're not feeding, they're not doing anything, they're just resting and they're being warm, and they're able to live all that time before they have to start out again in the spring, probably February or early March. Pretty amazing butterfly. And so I encourage all of you to have a little weedy patch and put some milkweed, which is a native plant, for the monarchs. And this one I took on a hike. This is the monarch caterpillar. It's a very beautiful looking caterpillar. And again, those markings are supposed to tell the birds that I'm poisonous because it's eating milkweed, which is toxic to most other living things. And then a couple of weeks before I took that picture, I had taken this one. And the milkweed, the little larva there, is smaller than the one we just saw, because if you look, let's see how big that caterpillar is compared to the flowers? And then the next picture, I'll learn how to use this thing. See how big these flowers are, and that's a very small caterpillar on that leaf. But also, I found this interesting beetle, the checkered beetle, or checkered clearing beetle, and they eat pollen. So this is my introduction to beetles and pollination. Because when you think of a beetle, you think, oh, no, I want that on my flower. But evolutionarily speaking, they and the flies were the first pollinators of the first flowers that were on this plant. And those were open cup-like flowers, like magnolias and that kind of thing. So the beetles were going to the pollen, and in the process of eating pollen, they also spread it around to the female part of the flower that was able to go to seed. So because beetles are in the order Coleoptera, they are, as it says, the largest group of insects, and they are great pollinators, even though they're not really doing a typical pollinator job. And I went out and took this picture here on my toyon bush. That's a native, or California holly, the toyon. And the toyon plant, the flowers have very wants to nest early, so typically she'll start nesting in as soon as the manzanita flowers start to bloom, which is typically late winter, sometime in March, and she'll start building her nest before the other ones come through to compete. The others are just traveling through pretty much on their way to other places. But most hummingbirds, they like tubular flowers. They like brightly colored flowers. And these are some things that you might already have in your yard, or you can buy some similar to them. So there again is the manzanita bloom. And the bumblebees like this too, because bumblebees have a long tongue and they can get up under those little flowers that are pointing down. You'll notice a lot of things that bloom in the winter hang down, so if it snows or rains, the nectar's not washed out. The same with the ribes or the wild currants, gooseberries. And then here's a hummingbird coming to that plant that the pollen wasp likes, the foothill pentagon. And sometimes they'll even go deeply into a big flower and get a dusting of pollen on its forehead like that. That's pretty amazing. And also their beak. So they pollinate that. This is a California fuchsia, a native around here, and blooms from July through November. It's a great one to have in your yard. So this is Dunnia, I think it's Chymosa. But this is one you'll see in the Merced River Canyon growing out of the rocks. And would you think that would be one that the hummingbird would like? Yeah. Brightly colored, tubular. And Barbara Robinson, I don't know if any of you know her, but she was the one who was banning hummingbirds for many years. And she took some great pictures. And she was surprised to see a hummingbird going to soaproot, which is a lily with a bulb that has the native, that has a very long stem with these white flowers in the summer. Because it's so white, it's not brightly colored, and it's not tubular. But then she took a closer look and said, wait a minute, the beak is open. It's not closed, the tongue's not coming out. So what is it doing? It's eating the little pollinators. These little, I'm not sure what these are, but they're little flies of some kind. And so another lesson learned. So if you have some of these plants in your yard, in your own garden, that would be great. The poker plant, this red one, is quite beautiful and attracts the butterflies and hummingbirds love this plant. Also, this is a sage. It's not a native, but it's sometimes mistaken as a native. It's Salvia fragii. And then you can also have that with the lilacs. Or excuse me, not the lilacs, the lavender for the bees. And you can see the hummingbird here, I think, coming up to the radii. And this was taken at the the drugstore in town, where they did some planting of rosemary, which was in bloom in the winter with the manzanita, and also the sage I was just talking about. So this is hummingbird heaven in the the winter. And just quickly, these are some other plants that you might want to incorporate into your yard, or maybe you already have some of them already in your yard, so try to keep them for all the pollinators. Not just butterflies or bees, but all the pollinators. And the more diversity you have, the more healthy environment. So next time you're going out, and you know what, the buckeye is beginning to bloom, depending on your elevation. It'll be blooming within the next couple of weeks. And this plant, even though it's poisonous to honeybees, because the European honeybee did not grow up here, so to speak, so it's a toxic plant, but all of our pollinators are immune to that because they evolved with this plant. So you will see so many butterflies and bees and birds all over this plant. And Dan took a picture, because he's curious, just like I am, but he's a better photographer. not a great picture because it was part of a video I was going to show you that I don't think is going to work. This is my last, pretty much my last slide. And what was happening here was that there were these sap holes on this tree, and the butterflies were there putting their tongue, their proboscis, in the sap holes because they like the sweet stuff. And the California sister lays its eggs in oak trees, so it provides, the caterpillars provide food for birds, but we have enough left over and it doesn't kill the tree. It all works out if nature is working properly. And this is also a California naturalist class. This is its mascot, the California sister. And you'll often see them on the ground. They do a lot of huddling. They like rotted fruit. So you can always attract them with your fruit that you didn't pick up in your orchards. But you see them around anyway. And I'll try and see if it'll work, but I don't think it will. Nope, didn't work, darn it. And there you go, where it has white foam. It's called alcoholic flux that comes out of oats that are kind of sick. But it's like a white foam. And they were going to that, and they're getting wrong. I mean, it's not only sweet, it's alcohol. And the flies were there, and they were like all bellying up to the bar. But anyway, it's fun. It's fun being out there, enjoying nature, and all this wonder. So, any questions at all?